No, well, this is a topic today that's close to our hearts.
Yes, and isn't a scary it? One.
Very
I have
close
to
our hearts today. Welcome to the Shtick, everybody. Eva?
Welcome to the Shtick. It's a very nerve-wracking subject, I've got to tell you.
No, it's like, what well,
not for you,
because
you're
of
done
nerves?
Already. You've been cut and chopped and pasted and the whole thing. Mm. But there are people now that I'm seeing, as you know, we've talked about this before, that symptoms for heart attacks are sometimes so unclear that you don't know it's happening until you're in the hospital being operated on. I find that scary.
I can't. I couldn't tell that when I was having a heart attack or if I was just having an argument with Lily. Well,
just tell me for 1 second what it felt like. What did you feel?
Well, when I
which
actually
part the first, was hurting.
Listen, I probably had several episodes of heart attacks that I didn't know were heart attacks at the time.
People have that.
Just feeling bad or whatever, and got over it.
Feeling bad in the chest.
Feeling bad in the chest or pain. Once was on a bike ride, one of my first long bike rides, and I felt really weak. And I was with a doctor, my doctor, in fact, not my cardiologist.
He didn't help.
But another doctor, and he said, you know, take it easy, rest for a bit. And I got past that, and I didn't think. But when it really happened was when I was going for a walk one day with Lily, and I couldn't.
You couldn't breathe.
I couldn't breathe. I couldn't walk, and I was feeling getting some pains in the chest. And I thought, this isn't right. This is not like.
And
the
so
other.
You actually acted on that straight away.
Yeah, straight away.
And went to the doctor.
So I went to the doctor, and then next day I was in with my cardiologist. And my cardiologist, Nathan Better, is going to be a guest on the show.
Yes.
In a little while, and we'll also have another cardiologist who specialises in Stephen Joseph.
In the technical.
He's also a cardiologist, but he also does pacemakers and defibrillators. You know, people
which
that
I find
I'm
is amazing.
Well acquainted with this sort of area. I'm a bit of
but it's the bionic man syndrome, isn't it? You get little devices implanted and you're okay.
Yeah, but not everyone has this sort of procedure and has that, but everyone should be aware of the risks to their health.
Yeah, well, at this obviously when you
especially
get...
Especially us, if we've been brought up on the sort of diets and
eating tongue, chopped liver, pure fat, gribbeniers. Oh, that's good. That's why you're okay now, because you don't eat that anymore.
Mm. Pure you know who might fat. Have something to say about this?
The rabbi?
Yeah, I think where's the rabbi?
Yeah, I think he gets himself checked up all the time.
Yes, he's a wise, he has sage words for us on this topic. We'll be back after the rabbi.
Hello and welcome to this special episode of The Shtick. And it's a very professional episode. Today we have got experts in the field of cardiology. They are going to tell us all about matters of the heart. And this is important to Jewish people and other people as well. Jews, we eat a diet rich in oil, soaked with... It's not good for you. You know, it gets into the vessels, it clogs up, and the heart, it runs into trouble. But from my perspective, the single biggest problem with the heart, the thing that makes the heart ache, is problems with the children. Every time I have congregants coming to me and they're saying, Rabbi, my heart is aching from this thing or that thing that's happening with the children. And then they go and comfort themselves by eating a ponchka, a fried gefilte fish ball, all those sort of things. And the cardiologists will tell them that stop eating those foods. Take medication for blood pressure, for cholesterol. They tell them to do all these sort of things to exercise. But the real problem has not gone away. And that is the problem caused by the children. So, if you really want to fix up your heartache, talk to your children. Tell them to behave themselves. Induce guilt. That's the secret to success, to cardiological health. Have a good week.
Oh, Yvette Menishkiet.
Do you feel okay?
You know, I could do with a bit of a checkup, I think.
Really?
Having palpitations. Small. Luckily, we have somebody who can do that for us here. Joining us on the show today, Nathan. This is Dr. Nathan Better, an eminent cardiologist. Because that's
Welcome
what it says on
show.
His card.
Thank you.
You're
going to
make
Barry.
Us feel better. Yeah. About this subject, because it's a very huge subject, as we know. And
have you got, like, are you like Kenny? Because Kenny's cardiology.
Who, the toilet guy?
No, they're those shops in all of the shopping centres. And they sell, you know, cardiology. I don't understand that. All of this happy birthday, 21st, and that. I can't see anything to do with the heart.
Really? Nathan, we're in our 50s. We have to admit this because, you know, we can't look 40s anymore. And I've been told that in our 50s is when so many of our age group end up having heart problems, going to the cardiologist. Is this just because of our age? Is it what happens because all of us in this decade are very well aware, like 10 years ago, didn't think about it, weren't worried about it. I've got evidence sitting in front of me, a man who's been cut up to pieces, who has a defibrillator. We're all the same age, and I've seen a lot of other people having to go through this. Why is it happening in our 50s?
Yeah, so it's probably at this point it's worth dividing it up into what we call primary prevention versus secondary prevention. And people who have had their heart cut up before or have defibrillators, we talk about secondary prevention. But your question specifically is looking at primary prevention and trying to stop heart attacks from occurring in the future. And I feel that the awareness that we're actually having on a day-by-day basis is actually growing in the community, and rightly so as well. What we used to think probably about 40 or 50 years ago was that women were protected and they were fine, and we now know that's not the case, and women getting heart disease is actually growing, and women have to be aware of these primary prevention issues.
Is that to do with, you know, women's equality?
We demand rights to heart attacks, 100%. No, because at my age, never had a problem. My whole family, most of them don't have high blood pressure, anything like that. Mine's been perfect. Suddenly, I have a stress test and it spiked to 190. Completely freaked out, and I now go to a cardiologist. This is a very weird thing for me, and I have to take blood pressure tablets.
They've changed. So they've changed the testing. They need more patients.
If it's not genetic, and okay, maybe I'm slowed down with exercise, but really, so what does that mean? Is it just my age that this is happening? Yeah, that's it.
There are lots of risk factors that we look at, and age is one of them in essence as well. If you don't control any of your risk factors, you still might never have a heart attack. But as each of these risk factors comes into play, your chances on the basis of probability slowly increases with each of these risk factors. And we know that if you can control these risk factors on a one-by-one basis, be it your blood pressure or diabetes, if you're a smoker and smoke to stopping smoking is an important issue.
This is not about hacking
me. What about funny cigarettes?
Funny cigarettes, probably not quite as important as tobacco.
But you're okay.
But there is always a bit of tobacco in them as well too, Barry.
No cigarettes, and look at him.
You see, there you have the advantage of me, Mr. Clean Cut.
Sorry, Barry.
That's right, Mr. Clean Cut, no drinking, no smoking, and so many people it happens to.
Was
and
it
that's, my in, parents, in your was case, it? It's genetic, yeah, I understand, yeah.
And the other two risk factors I was going to get to was weight and exercise, but
shut
importantly, family history as well.
Shut up.
Hang
now.
On.
Sorry, Barry.
We might need to go to a break soon.
You know, we're talking about not obese people, a little bit of extra weight, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, incrementally. Well, you know, you're only fitting half the couch, it's all right. But no, seriously, so it's incremental little thing. I mean, I have no idea. You know, I'm doing I don't eat badly, I don't think, you don't do this, don't do that, and it's still all happening.
All of these things are incremental. So if you have severe blood pressure problems as opposed to mild blood pressure problems, your risk is going to be greater. Similarly with your weight, same with your cholesterol. Also same with your family history, whether your family history is what we would call mildly positive or strongly positive. If you have both parents who have had heart disease in their 40s, then that makes it a little bit harder for you as well too.
Well, that's food for thought, and we'll come back to this topic, unfortunately, after the break.